scream?
Yes.
You will blaspheme?
Oh, yes.
You will no longer be responsible for your actions? Denounce your devilish master, Grandier, and we will save you.
This is Michael Gofford. He was a British character actor who had a short but fascinating career in a wide range of different movies. With his deep voice and compelling persona, he portrayed a wide gallery of interesting characters, mostly villains, but always with a special edge. For any serious movie freak out there, his filmography is a treasure trove. This is some of his work. Michael's first major leading role was in the arthouse film Herostratus. It's an experimental movie with a fragmented narrative. Michael plays Max, a young restless poet who contacts a marketing company with a proposal to broadcast his own suicide in front of the world. They accept this offer. At first, he enjoys the attention he receives, but as the story progresses and the deadline nears, he has second thoughts about his imminent suicide.
A good selling image for the general public.
Yes, a sort of hero image.
What do you think I'm, a box of detergent or something?
As far as we're concerned, you are. You put yourself in our hands, you really can't complain at the expert treatment you receive. A clear, positive image is all we ask.
After Herostratus, Michael's career was on its way. He got several more credits to his name and started working extensively in British and European movies of its time. Early on, he was typecast as villains.
Did you get anything last night?
Of course!
She was waiting for me in the pillory.
In the stocks.
It's true.
The Poles fight hard.
She was all spread out.
He won't like all those.
With her arms wide open. That's what I call service. Oh, I've never had it that way before. Did I ever tell you about the time I had it on a horse? Facing backwards and riding down a mountainside.
You raped that woman?
Yes. Had to be a rush job. The bed was on fire.
You raped that woman in chains?
That's right.
Hang him! Why?
He's my man, not yours. You!
Be calm. Look, I believe in law and order as much as anyone. What harm has he done? It's not the first time she gave pleasure.
Over there, anywhere, now!
Bastards!
All right, but do it quickly. I don't want the whole place in an uproar.
I do. I want them all to know.
Fix into the car, will you? Now, you won't bite through that, chummy. It's a pity they don't hang him anymore.
Yes, sir. Message received and understood.
This is the worst I've ever seen in my life. This man is just astonishing. I've seen nothing like it in my life, sir.
Well, you've done a hell of a job, Bill. Come along with me, would you?
Understood, sir. Thank you very much indeed, sir. Over and out, sir.
Watch out, then. Over and out.
The governor wants you to know he's very pleased with all this.
Get the bastard! Kill him! Bring up some animal photos, will you?
Right, sir.
Joyce, use the car. Head him up. How could he snap through high tensile steel?
He didn't.
Hey? Look.
Michael's next role would be in a controversial film that would forever change his audience perception of him as an actor. He would deliver a great performance in it, but due to its subject matter, the movie would remain hidden from public view for the next 40 years.
Speak, speak.
I could not rid my mind of this man for several days.
Who was this man?
There was a mist I couldn't see.
This is nothing. This public exorcism was a mistake. Let's stop it now before we become the laughingstock of the entire town.
We are unconvinced, my dear sister. And if our conviction remains untouched, I do not have to remind you that you face eternal damnation.
The Devils is not a film for everyone. Vanessa Redgrave, Oliver Reed, in Ken Russell's film of The Devils.
I am at your service, sir.
These raving women are possessed of devils, I take it?
Acting...
Oh, you lovely man!
Acting on the instigation of a priest, sir.
So I understand. Most amusing. Pray proceed.
Kiss me, kiss me!
Father Barry is Michael's most despicable and evil character in his entire filmography.
So then he'll go away like that. Ready? Go.
Confess, confess.
That's it, sir. See how he's got it? The spit and the cross going at the same time, so he just naturally goes away.
Ken Russell's controversial masterpiece was banned in several countries on its release. As of today, Warner Brothers has been reluctant to release the movie on Blu-ray due to its subject matter. It's a real shame because it's one of the best British movies of the 1970s.
That was no devil. She spoke with her own voice, the voice of a frustrated woman. That's enough.
Do not be so easily deceived. Her very innocence is a sham. A mask of deceit devised by the cunning of Satan. Be assured, the fiend is silently lurking in some hidden recess of her body. This medical examination will reveal, and then we shall do battle.
Father Barry, it is I speaking to you now. Sister, you have a very
just... You speak with many voices! Christ, protect me from the fangs of Satan!
Thank you, Matthew! Oh, dear Jesus!
Silent beast! Ready, Bear.
We're ready.
Then drive out the fiend.
After a grueling 3-month shoot on The Devils, Michael decided to go to the other side of the world, far, far away from the English cold. He accepted a leading role in the French drama film, The Valley. Pink Floyd produced the music for the film, later released as the album Obscured by Clouds. It's an interesting forgotten 70s movie with a true hippie spirit. We follow a young French woman who meets Michael's character, Oliver, and she joins him and his friends on an expedition in Papua New Guinea. They fall in love, but their relationship gets tested during that long journey. It's one of the few movies where Michael speaks French, which he learned as a young man in Paris in the early 60s.
Dépêche pas, parce qu'il est lent, c'est lent ici.
Si vous me racontiez un peu votre vie, ça vous calmerait.
Pas grand chose à dire.
Mon mari est consul de France à Melbourne. Et moi, comme j'ai horreur de la vie mondaine, j'achète des objets océaniens, des plumes, des tissus, pour une boutique à Paris. Quoi dire encore? Je fais du piano. J'ai une très jolie collection d'orchidées. Et j'ai un petit chien aussi, si ça vous intéresse.
Comment ça s'appelle?
Nuki.
C'est un joli nom.
Children don't want to leave here. You have a home now, forever.
Whoever slew Auntie Rue. Whoever slew Auntie Rue.
Whoever slew Auntie Rue is a weird old-school horror movie, drawing inspiration from the Hansel and Gretel story. Shelley Winters plays an evil widow who kidnaps young children into a British countryside mansion.
Merry Christmas to you.
And a rotten New Year to you.
Michael plays her butler, Albie, who finds out about her crimes and decides to blackmail her.
Unless you give me 2,000 quid, Rosie, I'm going to have to report to the police that you've become a kidnapper. You've got Katie locked in the nursery, haven't you? Haven't you?
Go get me my checkbook.
After making a small cameo in the two Musketeer movies that was shot back to back, Michael had a 4-year break from acting without booking a new role. But in 1978, he was back in business.
The city. City in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean.
You will not find it on any map, but you know its name.
Atlantis.
Warlords of Atlantis is a silly but charming little B-movie with a lot of monsters and old-school practical effects. Despite the goofy material, Michael delivers the dialogue in his booming voice with utmost sincerity and commitment.
Escape the world of Atlantis.
The movie did little to further advance Michael's career, but it has true cult movie moments, illustrated by this next scene.
Holy, dear, don't do that, you'll frighten it away.
Well, I'm not gonna invite him in for tea, Charlie. Come on, we're getting out of here.
Michael's most recognizable role would be as the henchman Emil Leopold Locke in the 1981 James Bond film For Your Eyes Only. Michael never speaks a single line of dialogue throughout the entire movie. Although Locke as a character is a little bit underdeveloped, he strikes a menacing presence, and his character appears in all the best set pieces of the movie.
Sir, the man we want is Emil Leopold Locke,
an enforcer in the Brussels underworld. He's been convicted of several particularly brutal murders. He has worked for drug syndicates in Marseille and Hong Kong. Now reported working for Greek smugglers. The Italian Secret Service think that he is at this moment in Cortina.
Walter PPK, standard issue, British Secret Service.
License to kill or be killed. Take him away.
Michael's final scene in the movie is a well-directed action sequence where Bond chases after Locke and kicks his car over a cliff. It's a finishing move that is unexpected from Roger Moore's version of the Bond character, who never killed a villain in Cold Blood.
You left this with Ferrara, I believe. Had no head for heights.
In 1985, Michael joined the cast of Tobe Hooper's Life Force. Life Force is a wild and bonkers 80s sci-fi, which today is regarded as a cult movie. It was one of the few canon movies made at the time with a big studio budget behind it. But the movie underperformed at the box office and was not a commercial hit. Michael plays Dr. Bukowski, a scientist who is one of the first characters to come in contact with the space girl, played by Matilda May.
Tell me again how the girl overpowered you.
She was the most overwhelmingly feminine presence I've ever encountered. I was drawn to her on a level that...
Was it sexual?
Yes, overwhelmingly so. And horrible. Loss of control.
And the man, the guard, was dead when you came into the room. You found him as he is now.
Yeah.
And the girl, she came from the ship, Churchill.
Colonel. May I be excused? I seem to be feeling a little more nauseous than I thought.
Yes, of course.
Hold on, boys.
Hey, where do you think you're going?
Where's Abilene?
Llewellyn did deliver a baby that night. A Mrs. Ken Dinsky. There was no clock in the house, so we don't know exactly when he left.
Keep him on the list.
I told you, your guy nowhere.
Where's he hiding?
You once.
Abilene! Abilene!
A bit late to finish work, isn't
it? I want a word with you. The name's Lusk. George Lusk. I'm chairman of
the so-called Vigilante Committee.
As a quick side note, this was not the first time the two Michaels met in a scene.
The penalty for rape will be public castration.
I wonder when you were going to show your face.
I'll show you more than a face, Abilene.
That's right. Yeah.
I'll show you 100 armed men.
And what might they be for?
Yeah. He can't keep the streets safe for ordinary working people.
That's right.
So we're gonna help you.
Are you now? Well, unplug your ears, Lusk, because I'm gonna tell you something. I grew up with these people, and they matter to me. I know what matters to you. It's written all over your face. Power. So take my advice and go home. The revolution may not start this week.
Come on in.
By the 1990s, Michael's career was in serious decline. He had several gap years in his resume, and his credits became less distinguished. On a cold December day in 1992, he committed suicide in his own home. He was 53 years old. Michael once said that an actor is just a cog in the machine. I sometimes wonder if he ever felt disillusioned by the big machinery of movie making. That his professional stagnation somehow fueled his own depression. I guess we will never know. But although Michael might be gone, he still lives forever in the movies he left behind.